Terrence McDonald, our second speaker today. He is the Arthur F. Thurnau Professor of History and the current director of the Bentley Historical Library. He's a former Guggenheim Fellow and the winner of several prestigious awards, both for his teaching and his scholarship. Terry is known to many of us, though, as our fearless leader in his role as the Dean of LS&A for a remarkable and lengthy tenure before his transition to the Bentley last autumn. And we are delighted to have him give his reading of Angel Hall's facade with his talk, Up, Up and Away, Memorializing the Ordinance of 1787. Professor Terry McDonald, everyone.
I should begin with a plug for the Bentley Library. All the questions that are being asked today about Angel Hall, about Albert Kahn, about the Regents, the president of the university, are all, of course, in the archives at the Bentley Historical Library. And so you're welcome to come up and take a look and answer all the questions for yourself. When I was dean of LS&A, I had a dream. And in it, every student and faculty member walked up the steps of Angel Hall or toward the steps of Angel Hall, noticed a great quotation on its pediment, and reflected on its meaning and history. It says, of course, religion, morality, and knowledge being necessary to good government and the happiness of mankind, schools and the means of education shall forever be encouraged. Inspired by the political foundations of the university's radical historical public purpose, they then walked under the pediment and into the astonishing intellectual world of the college, symbolized by the departmental contents of Angel Hall, and the arrangement of most of the college's other disciplines around the diag. But it was only a dream. I soon discovered that almost no one could see the great quotation, that the builders had left off the source of the quotation, and therefore even those who did happen to see the quotation had no idea from where it came. The memorializing of the ordinance on the pediment, which undoubtedly was done with the best of intentions, unwittingly removed it from the consciousness of most, if not all, students and faculty. It was not always like this. In fact, on Sunday, June 26, 1887, the University of Michigan celebrated its semi-centennial at the graduation ceremony of the then six departments of the university, including, of course, our own literary department. The faculty editorial committee, whose account of these events was published, wrote, quote, "At the close of the singularly beautiful day outdoors, the graduating classes of the six departments of the university assembled at their appointed places on the campus and marched in procession to University Hall. They filed into the great hall and occupied the two entire sections reserved for them in front of the stage. The remaining seats of the hall, including the galleries, were filled to overflowing by students, alumni, invited guests, and other visitors and friends of the university. The hall had been appropriately decorated by the committee charged with that duty. The lower background of the stage was draped with the American flag enfolding the coat of arms of the state. On either side were artists' palettes containing silver letters on blue, the date 1837-1887. Across the upper background of the stage was frescoed in conspicuous letters the legend from the famous ordinance, religious morality and knowledge being necessary to good government and the happiness of mankind, etc." Now we can walk the paths of these 1887 students today, using a little leisure domain by taking pictures of what they saw from actually different periods of history. This is the great pile called University Hall, which was the predecessor of Angel Hall. In fact, it was built just to the east of the site that Angel Hall now occupies. The students would form up for graduation on the diag. They would usually enter the back of University Hall, which is the side that faced the diag. They would proceed into the auditorium. University Hall had been opened in 1873, just east of what became the site of Angel Hall. At its heart was this astonishing 4,000-seat auditorium, which at the time was not only the largest in the university and in the city of Ann Arbor, but among the largest, if not the largest, of any academic building in America. The auditorium was a celebratory heart of the university, the place where all large gatherings and meetings were held, including all faculty meetings, memorials, and commencements. It was also used for lectures, dramatic, and musical presentations, and it was the home of the first of the University Musical Society's May festivals in the 1890s. Among others, Matthew Arnold spoke on the stage of the auditorium, and it was deemed to be a boring failure. It was not, by the way, because it looks that way, the chapel. The chapel was in this building, but it was in a separate room from the auditorium. And you note, of course, that people had developed strong butts from going to church so much, so these were just basically church pews that held 4,000 people. So we're walking in, we see the auditorium, but of course on this day, it's packed. And this is what it was like. Now notice, this was on the second floor of this building. It was the world's greatest fire trap, for sure. So this is what it looked like on the day of 1887, filled with 4,000 people to the rafters. And this is what they saw. Religion, morality, and knowledge being necessary to good government and the happiness of mankind over the stage of University Hall. Each one of those symbols, it's hard to see in this picture, is a lamp. In his address on that day in 1887, President Angell, who was the president after whom Angell Hall is named, of course, declared that the ordinance, commonly called the Northwest Ordinance, contained the germ of the life of the university and all state universities in the West. For that reason, he said, the passage of the ordinance had been placed upon the walls of the great auditorium of University Hall because it was a sentence which, quote, should be engraved in letters of gold on fitting monuments in every state that was carved out of the Northwest Territory. The ordinance was, he said, the great charter of freedom and intelligence for this region, which has endowed institutions of learning from the lowest to the highest by the gift of public lands. As Angell pointed out that day, the material effect of the spirit of the ordinance was the congressional action of the United States in 1804, which reserved for sale for the support of education a township of land, which is 36 square miles, in each of the three divisions of the territory of Indiana that would themselves become states, including Michigan. To this land grant of 36 square miles, the Native American tribes of Chippewa and Potawatomi had granted three more sections, 108 square miles, for the, quote, College of Detroit in the Treaty of Fort Meigs in 1817. In part, frankly, because this land was available for this purpose and its grants had withstood a series of legal challenges, a series of acts were taken by the territorial and state legislatures attempting to organize the university, culminating in the State Legislature's Act of 1837, declaring that, quote, there shall be established in this state an institution under the name and style of the University of Michigan. The object of the university shall be to provide the inhabitants of the state with the means of acquiring a thorough knowledge of the various branches of literature, science, and the arts. The government of the university shall be vested in a board of regents. That was 1837. I had to read that so we could all see where the antique name of Allisonnais actually came from. It was actually in the first legislation organizing the university. Knowledge of the various branches of literature, science, and the arts. But it was not the material effects of this ordinance that were celebrated in this auditorium in University Hall from 1887 until the rise of Angell Hall in 1924-25. It was rather its ideological effects that were constructed as the university's academic and political culture and heritage were ritualized, solemnized, and celebrated in University Hall. The ordinance is what all students and all visitors to the campus saw every time they entered the auditorium. More than that, they learned it and its history. After University Hall was sadly condemned and scheduled for demolition in 1925, Wilford B. Shaw, an alumnus himself and director of alumni relations for the university, pointed out that, quote, every student in the university memorized it perforce. We had it before us at every university function, and we can all say it backwards and forwards. The legislative history of the ordinance and its effects actually begins with the Land Act of 1784, and as much as historians like me enjoy legislative history, I will spare you a detailed review of it, but say that like most American legislation, the process that led to the passage of the Northwest Ordinance in 1787 was a mix of high ideals, bare-knuckled interest group politics, and close calls. We would be naive to think otherwise. A first version of the ordinance was written by Thomas Jefferson, and in part for that reason, the version that passed in 1787 was a disappointing combination of bizarrely specific definitions of landholding and uplifting revolutionary rhetoric. But that rhetoric was important because it established what our colleague Taya Miles has reminded us in another look at the ordinance, was the emancipatory potential of the ordinance. In the end, it called forth five crucial elements of that potential in the territory that became the states of Ohio, Indiana, Michigan, Wisconsin, and Minnesota. These were the states of the Northwest Territories. First, equal rights. The ordinance established the process for admitting states after the original 13 on a ground of equality with the revolutionary states. The territories west of those 13 original colonies would be admitted as states equal to those who fought the revolution, and their citizens would hold equal rights with them. This was a non-colonial approach to adding territory. Second principle, free soil. Slavery was prohibited in this territory for the first time that the federal government had ever prohibited slavery anywhere in the United States. Third, free conscience. Religious freedom was guaranteed in the region. Fourth, free labor. The federal lands in these areas, most of its acreage, were to be sold to small holders and not granted to large holders. And fifth, free education. As I mentioned, the land had been reserved as above vast tracts of land to support free public education all the way through the university. Taken together, these provisions of the Northwest Ordinance were really among the most radical political provisions in the history of the world. A utopian plan for the shaping of a region that at that time was widely regarded as the outer edge of the world known to white settlers in the United States. It was a 2.5-day trip from New York to Boston in 1800, an arduous 4-week overland trip to Detroit in the same year. The ordinance looked back to the revolutionary founders, of course, having been co-authored by Thomas Jefferson, and forward to a new kind of political entity in America and the world. Most Americans in the North in the 19th century came to believe that the ordinance had saved the Union in the Civil War, practically by adding, of course, 5 non-slavery states to the Union, ideologically by keeping them there, especially in the border states like Ohio and Indiana, and encouraging 1 million men from these states to join the Union Army. That much of the legislation in the Northwest Ordinance was indeed rhetoric, rather than detailed planning and specific language, should go without saying. In fact, the ordinance launched intense political battles over all these principles in all the states and territories of the region. One of its planks, calling for reasonable treatment of the Native Americans in the region, for example, was an abject failure. But that is really not the point. The power of its ideological emancipatory potential was great. Equal rights, free soil, free conscience, free labor, free education were both the means for and the platforms on which many good things were built, including not only many great public universities, but most of the rights claims that came later in the 19th and 20th century. It was rightfully in front of every audience in University Hall, and the opening of the Albert Kahn buildings, Hill Auditorium in 1913 and Angel Hall in 1924, both separated the artistic, ceremonial, and political realms and moved the last out of the realm of legibility with the full, if possibly unwitting, cooperation of university officials. And so back to today. What exactly are the political traditions of public universities today? Annual lamentation over the lack of funding from their states, perhaps. With what great radical historical and/or utopian projects are public universities in America affiliated today? Has the seat of ritualized celebration and political culture shifted from the central campus to the stadium? Indeed, how architecturally today would one know if she set foot on the campus of a public university? What is left of this legible as opposed to memorialized tradition on this campus? I leave you with a quiz. Where is this motto now found right next to the fire extinguisher? Thank you.
Does anyone know the answer to that question? I do. I actually just saw it yesterday.
I'm listening.
Once again, no source, no label. Yeah. Yes.
So, well, is it the table?
Yeah.
Yes.
It's the second floor lobby. Like. Yeah, second floor lobby. Yeah.
So my question is about religion. Why is it first, and how has that had any kind of an impact on the university's relationship with religion?
Sure. Let me first of all say two things that one of which I think you'll immediately remember. There were almost no public universities in America in 1817. Right, almost all universities were sectarian, so the religious universities were the basic trend. Moreover, there still were official established religions in the 13 states before the Constitution was passed in 1789. So the Bill of Rights had not been passed when the Northwest Ordinance was passed. So this was a premonition of the Bill of Rights and the Proclamation of Freedom of Religion. Now, in reality, of course, what this meant, what the Northwest Ordinance meant, and what the university, how the university functioned, was frankly a sort of non-sectarian Protestant evangelical religious culture permeated the place. So the reason that University Hall had a chapel in it was because as soon as University Hall, there was a required chapel every day for all the students at the University of Michigan in the 19th century until probably the 1880s, I think, when it was made voluntary. So for every liberatory potential or emancipatory potential of the Northwest Ordinance, there's another side of it, which the way each of these terms was defined wasn't necessarily, you know, quite as emancipatory as it might be. So for example, religious freedom was declared, but the university, for all practical purposes, functioned as an evangelical Protestant kind of place, even though it was non-sectarian. And that was a very big value on the campus, was a non-sectarian approach to religion.